Welcome, Western swing lovers. Eclectic American Roots Matinee has created dozens of online shows centered around the history of roots music. Now, it's time to acknowledge one of the earliest roots music innovators, a legend who helped create the phenomenon known as Western swing. Aha!
That's San Antonio Rose!
Bob Wills' San Antonio Rose sold nearly 2 million records. And today, over the great radio networks, the lovable melodies go out to cities and villages, farms and mansions.
Ninety years ago, Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys were barnstorming through Texas, Oklahoma, and California with their souped-up blend of fresh-sounding dance music, now known as Western Swing.
Chicken and flew upstairs, goodbye, goodbye. All caught a chicken and flew upstairs, goodbye, Liza Jane.
Oh, how I love her, ain't that a shame? Oh, how I love her, goodbye, Liza Jane.
River and round the bend, goodbye, goodbye. Six shooters on and gone again, goodbye, Liza Jane.
Oh, how I love her, ain't that a shame? Oh, how I love her, goodbye, Liza Jane.
Chase that rabbit, chase that squirrel, goodbye, goodbye. Chase that pretty girl around the world, goodbye, Liza Jane.
Oh, how I love her, ain't that a shame? Oh, how I love her, goodbye, Liza Jane.
Grab your partner and turn around, goodbye, goodbye. Let your little foot jar the ground, goodbye, Liza Jane.
Oh, how I love her, ain't that a shame? Oh, how I love her, goodbye, Liza Jane.
One wheel off off in the axle dragging. Goodbye, goodbye. You can't ride in the little red wagon. Goodbye, Liza Jane.
Oh, how will of her, ain't that a shame? Oh, how will of her, goodbye, Liza Jane.
Born in Turkey, Texas in 1905, James Robert Wills was the oldest of 10 children, born to a fiddle-playing father and grandfather. As a young cotton picker, Wills loved the soulful sound of the old blues tunes he would hear out in the field. He heard swing and country music on the radio, and he soon became a restless son of the Depression, yearning to strike out for the big city and make music that got couples dancing. At 18, Wills' family moved to Memphis, Texas, where Jim Robb began playing the fiddle at square dances. He became Bob Wills after working in a medicine show that had too many Jims. At age 24, Bob began performing at dances in the Fort Worth area. He soon met Milton Brown, and together they formed the Light Crust Doughboys to perform on a sponsored radio program. In 1932, they began recording for the Victor label, which was a big deal back then.
I had someone else before I had you, and I'll have someone after you've gone. A streetcar, a sweetheart, don't worry me, there'll soon be another one along. You needn't stay, go any day. I've got a swinging door right in my heart, and it swings either way. I had someone else before I had you, and I'll have someone after you've gone.
Now, Wills got fired from the Doughboys in 1933 due to his excessive drinking, a bad habit he maintained during his entire career. He then took his banjo-playing brother, Johnny Lee Wills, and popular singer Tommy Duncan to form his own outfit, Bob Wills and the Playboys. Ex-bandmate Milton Brown died in a car crash just a few years later, giving Wills the freedom to be known as the King of Western Swing. Now named the Texas Playboys, the band continued to play on the radio with different companies to sponsor the band, all the time playing local dances.
Fisher's, America's finest flouring mills, presents the music of America's number one Western swing band, Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys.
Bob Wills was just an average fiddle player at best, but his strength was being a superb band leader and songwriter. Plus, he had remarkable skills at musical arrangements. Wills was an innovator. He combined jazz sophistication, pop music, and blues influences. Plus, his improvised scats and wisecrack commentary, which is something he learned performing in those medicine shows, really came to the fore. The Texas Playboys were on their way. Our video host today is Mitch Polzak. Like Bob Wills, he's a musical innovator and performs around the world with his band, the Royal Deuces. Polzak plays music from the late 50s Sun Records era. He plays guitar instrumentals from influences like Joe Mathis, Merle Travis, and Chet Atkins, and has a wide range of Bakersfield honky-tonk music. Mitch also adds the five-string banjo to his show, bringing in the influence of Earl Scruggs and Ralph Stanley. Let's see what he has put together for his first video segment today. Mitch Polzak.
It don't matter who's in Austin, Bob Wills is still the king. Thank you, Christopher Burkhardt. It's a pleasure to be on Eclectic American Roots today, talking about the King of Western Swing, Bob Wills, and his amazing band, the Texas Playboys. Had to quote that little bit of Waylon there to get things started, because I just love that line so much. Don't matter who's in Austin, Bob Wills is still the king. So, we're going to be talking about a few different things about Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys today. on Eclectic American Roots. The first thing we're going to be talking about is Will's Point, which was established in 1947 right here in the great state of California, just a few miles north of Sacramento on Highway 99. Will's Point was purchased by Bob Wills himself in 1947. The demand was so great for Bob's music in California, he moved his entire base of operations out of Texas to the Golden State, where a large migration of people had come to seek jobs during World War II. So out in the Central Valley in the San Joaquin, Bob Wills and his band, the Texas Playboys, at Will's Point would play five nights a week. Now this was like a honky-tonk heaven. There was a full-size swimming pool. There was houses for band members. There was a giant auditorium which could hold up to 1,000 people. Five nights a week, 600 to 1,000 people would attend to see and hear Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. The demand was so great that Bob was able to keep the band on site. We have word from Vance Terry when he was still alive, when he was talking with Billy Wilson, who is a well-known steel guitar player and musician out in California, that Vance told Billy that there was a rigorous schedule set up for rehearsals. The band would rehearse 8 in the morning to noon, break for lunch, rehearse from 1 p.m. to 5 p.m., break for dinner, and then perform starting at either 8 p.m. or 9 p.m. to midnight or 1. And the thing about Bob Wills, once you were on stage, he never took a break. So you were working and you didn't get off stage. The band would do this five nights a week. That is an extremely rigorous schedule. Now, in order to keep this going, Bob had housing for the band at Will's Point. There was a little school facility in which children of the band members were actually taught, and his youngest brother, Billy Jack Wills, would often manage and perform there when Bob was out on the road. Bob was out on the road so much that he hired his mandolin player, Tiny Moore, to manage Will's Point. Tiny Moore managed Will's Point from 1950 to about 55 or 56. Tiny Moore was an electric mandolin player and excelled at creating that electrified, high-driven, high-energy sound of Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. Folks who were not in the band, tourists, passerbys, could join in the fun and festivities and would go swimming at Will's Point. I remember hearing firsthand experiences of that from our dear friend, the late Marty Jara, who grew up in Central Valley, California. He remembers being a kid going to Will's Point and swimming in the pool. And you could do that. It was open, it was fun, it was incredible. And people would come from miles around to hear the band and get down, have a good time. All from 1947 to the early 60s, this was a hub of Western Swing music in Sacramento. The Western Swing Hall of Fame out here in California was actually established in Sacramento for this reason. The venue mysteriously burned down. There's not too many details on that. It's kind of hazy. And not too much footage exists on YouTube or the internet about Will's Point. So a lot of what we have is hearsay, brief video clips from folks who are 1 or 2 degrees of separation to Will's Point. But the thing that is so fascinating is that in California, Western Swing was so popular, and Bob Wills and Billy Jack Wills were so popular that they were able to maintain the successful establishment for almost two decades and a half. In our next segment, we're going to be talking about some of the great performers and steel guitar players and guitar players that made Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys part of who they are. Let's enjoy some music.
Seven, eight, or nine, but now they're gone. We don't wear these. We're sitting on top of the world. Yes, the world. All right, Bobby. One sunny day, that's when you left me, baby. You've got thrown away. If you see me stealing, don't tell on me. Just stealing back to my used to be. But now she's gone. I don't worry, 'cause I'm sitting on top of the world. What a world. Come in, Jody. An evening, honey, babe, way after school. Remember, darling, we broke the rule. But now you're gone, I don't worry, 'cause I'm sitting on top of the world.
I want to introduce a contributor who is a Grammy Award-winning Texas musician, Bobby Flores of the Yellow Rose Band. Bobby has appeared on over 400 albums. He's a composer of music for radio and TV all over the US and Europe. He started performing in 1968 when he was just 7 years old, singing gospel with his mother. At nine, he was featured in a country band, and by the mid-80s, he was the fiddle player for Johnny Bush. In 1997, he became first fiddle for the Ray Price Band and then earned a Grammy in 2002 for arranging strings and brass on a Freddie Fender CD. Many music awards followed, and 6 years ago, he was Ameripolitan's Western Swing Male. He's here today to chat about a memory of his concerning another Texan, Doug Somm. Welcome, Bobby Flores.
I really don't think we can give Bob Wills enough credit for what he did, what he actually created with the Western swing sound. Of course, being a pioneer of that sound, mixing jazz, blues, Dixieland, it was really brilliant. And he always had these really large bands, and I love how he incorporated horns, fiddles, everybody playing parts. Just a fantastic sound, upright bass. And of course, he always had fantastic musicians working with him as well. So he had a really great thing going. I want to tell you just a real quick Doug Somm story. I got to work with Doug the last few years of his life, and we became good friends. And he would always tell me that when he was a kid, him and his friend used to cross these really dark fields to the cabaret, which is in Bandera, Texas, it used to be. And he said it would be totally pitch dark, and they'd be walking through these dark pastures, and they could see the cabaret, and they could hear Bob Wills and the band playing. And I've run that in my mind so many times, just thinking, what a unique time that was, when there was nothing else around, and you're walking up to this club at night, and you're hearing the upright bass popping and the drums and everybody playing, and him and his buddy, they were too young to get in, so they would look through the windows, and they'd stand by the door, and they'd listen to Bob and his band play. But, thanks to Bob, we get to mix, bebop and jazz and everything with Western swing, so it's a real playground, for musicians who like to improvise. And, he was fantastic, and he was a gift, and we play a lot of his music live. So, thank you, Bob Wills.
Here's one from our friends from Oklahoma. Stole my heart away from me way down in Louisiana. Take me back to Tulsa, I'm too young to marry. Take me back to Tulsa, I'm too young to marry. Susie, take me back to Tulsa, I'm too young to marry. Take me back to Tulsa, I'm too young to marry. Stop it, Flores.
Country, play music by the hour.
Take me back to Tulsa, I'm too young to marry. Take me back to Tulsa, I'm too young to marry.
Our next musical guest had a 7-piece swing band in Arizona back in the 90s, followed by a 17-piece big band that toured the Southeast. After a music career in New Orleans, he moved to Southern California with the Johnny Holiday Show. Today, he writes and arranges for his own Western swing band, dubbed the Southwest Biscuit Company. Please welcome the band leader, Mr. Jody Byrd.
Thank you, Christopher. Man, I love an opportunity to get to talk about Western Swing and Bob Wills especially. So thank you for having me. First off, I'll tell you guys a little story about the origins of the name of my band, the Southwest Biscuit Company. That is an homage to two different people, Bob being one of them. Southwest part comes from my background. I was born in Phoenix, Arizona. So that is an homage to my background, my upbringing. And one of my favorite artists and songwriters, Marty Robbins, was also from Arizona. So that's where the Southwest part comes from. Now, Biscuit Company, that part comes from Bob Wills and is my homage to Bob Wills and his first band, the Light Grow Doughboys. So, because they helped start everything. So, now you know, that's where the name comes from. If anybody ever asks you, you can tell them. So, as far as the influence his music had on us, I mean, you can't do Western Swing without Bob Wills. It's impossible. Because even the artists other than Bob Wills back then, they were also influenced by Bob Wills because he did it all before anybody. So, you know, I mean, he was a big reason a lot of bands got started, us included. So with that, we definitely have some great Bob Wills numbers that we love to cover. And one of my favorites, and I hope it's one of yours, we got a barn burner for you folks. I would love to share with you guys our version of My Window Faces the South. And thank you so much.
My window faces the south. I'm almost halfway to heaven. The snow is falling, but all I can see fields of cotton smiling at me. My window faces the south. And though I'm far from the swatting, I'm never drowning or down in the mouth. My window faces the south. Smiling at me, my window faces the south. Hello, I'm far from the Swanee. I've never tried in no town in my window faces the south. My window faces the south. My window faces the south. Thank you very much.
In the 1930s, Bob Wills Band became the first superstars of the genre. They already played Texas fiddle tunes, old blues, big band, jazz, just about anything else that could get the fans dancing. Wills went even bigger, adding a drummer, Smokey Dacus, in 1935, and then a horn section. He added Leon McAuliffe on steel, and he was also a singer. Wills and his 13-piece orchestra, with Tommy Duncan on vocals, filled every square inch of air in the enormous dance halls and ballrooms of Texas and Oklahoma, eventually outdrawing even Tommy Dorsey and Harry James orchestras. A true visionary, Wills went from a dance hall fiddler to the leader of an 18-piece band and toured the Southwest. Imagine life on the road as the group performed their 4-hour-long shows with no breaks on a regular circuit, driving hundreds of miles a week throughout North Texas, Arkansas, Kansas and Oklahoma, where they were based.
It's just a lot of fun to play a dance, jump in your cars and drive 300 or 400 miles and sleep an hour or two, shave and go play another dance and drive another 500 or 600 miles. And
they maintained a daily noon radio show broadcast live from the Keynes Academy in Tulsa. So every night, wherever they happened to be, they had to drive back to Tulsa after performing. The Texas Playboys went fully electric way before anyone else and helped make the steel guitar a standard instrument for country music. By combining reeds, brass, and twin fiddles, it gave the Playboys a full and rich sound. The version of the classic San Antonio Rose, recorded in 1940, brought Wills and the band national acclaim, and the Texas Playboys were outselling the top swing bands like Benny Goodman. In 1943, the band got up to 23 members. Now, riding his new popularity, along with the Texas Playboys, Wills co-starred with Tex Ritter in Take Me Back to Oklahoma, and then Go West, Young Lady, in Hollywood. Other films would follow. Here are some examples of Bob Wills in the movies.
Back in low trouble, big steep hill to climb.
Yo, honey, she's done left you, and you ain't got a dime.
Keep hubbing it, son, it's your wagon load. Keep right on hubbing it down that lonesome road.
How's the world been treating you? Made your fortune yet?
The world ain't been a-treating me. I pay for what I get.
Keep hubbing it, son, it's your wagon load. Keep right on hubbing it down that lonesome road.
You're from Texas. You talk the lingo I understand. I'll bet my kale that you hail from Texas, cause there's no mistake in the brand. You've got a smile like an acre of sunflowers, and your eyes are a blue bonnet blue.
Shake hands, it's grand. You're from Texas, cause I'm from Texas too.
That's funny. You're taking the girl's tip off just like that, and poor old Cannonball seemed to doubt him.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that you're deliberately trying to hold us back to protect that girl's brother. Fellas, are you going to stick with this moonstruck sheriff or ride with me to Dry Gulch, Square Joe's killing?
Sorry, boys, but I couldn't let that hot-headed ramrod of yours lead you into a trap.
How do you know it's a trap?
I don't. We're going to Dry Gulch, all right, but not the way he was going to lead you. Cannonball, you stay with him till he comes to. Come on.
In addition to the 1940 film Take Me Back to Oklahoma, Wills appeared in a total of 19 films during the war years, including The Lone Prairie, Saddles and Sagebrush, and The Rhythm Roundup.
In my adobe hacienda, there's a touch of Mexico. Cactus lovelier than orchids, blooming in the patio.
During this period, World War II was on, and a lot of entertainers were in the military. Tommy Duncan and Leon McAuliffe both joined, and Wills joined the Army. But he received a medical discharge in 1943. After the war, Wills reorganized the Playboys. He downsized his expensive big band and kept touring with mostly stringed instruments. Here's our video host, Mitch Polzak, again. He's compiled some really cool videos for our Bob Wills segment today.
All right! This is so fantastic to continue in the celebration of the music of Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys, as well as celebrate the wonderful music of our contemporary artists who are out there in the field playing this music day in and day out, and hopefully we'll be playing it again more as the pandemic subsides. Now, one of the great things here is we're going to delve in even deeper to what makes the sound of Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys tick. Now, the thing we're going to look at is the steel guitar players and the six-string slingers of Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. Now, jazz relied more on a horn section, piano arrangements, and jazz was also incredibly popular at this time. Western swing emphasized stringed instruments, steel guitar, violin, fiddle, regular guitar, electrified mandolin. This sound really, really, really defined Western swing. Now, the steel guitar players who Bob Wills had in his bands over the years are the Mount Rushmore of steel guitar players. Now keep in mind, this was the 30s, the 40s, the 50s. Bob Wills was at the height of his career. He was the man. And when you're in that demand, you attract the best players. One of the first players that Bob Wills hired was an incredible steel guitar player named Leon McAuliffe, who we often hear Bob go, "Oh yeah, take it away, Leon." There's even a picture of Leon McAuliffe, and he's got "Take It Away, Leon" on his steel guitar. That's classic. Now, one of the great things about this sound is not only do you have an electrified guitar being able to take leads, you also have this really unique distorted sound that was coming out of the amps at the time. Now, at this point in history, PA systems were very limited in their audio capacity. Electricity given into amps was still a very new thing. So in order to be heard at venues where 500 to 1,000 people were carrying on, stomping, maybe fighting, the threat of hanky-panky, who knows, everything that happens at a hot California Western Swing event, or Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, any place Bob was playing, there's going to be a good time, and it's going to get loud. So in order for these leads to be heard, any steel guitar player, electric guitar player, electric mandolin player would have to crank their amps. And that gave us the beginning of a distorted electric guitar tone. Sometimes we associate that with rock and roll of the 60s or the 70s. Friends, this sound was happening in the 30s, was happening with blues artists as well, which is very exciting to listen to these two genres of music coming into their own with an electrified sound. Now, I had mentioned Leon McAuliff. Right now, we're going to enjoy and listen to a recording made in 1937 that Leon did called the Steel Guitar Stomp. Now, you hear in this recording with the whole band, the steel guitar really pushing that amp. And this is in the studio. So just imagine yourself at the live venue and you're going to see Leon McAuliff. You're going to hear him rip it on steel guitar stomp, and you're going to want to dance and have a good time. Let's take a listen to the 1937 recording of Leon McAuliff with the Texas Playboys performing the steel guitar stomp.
Stand by, friends. Here's Leon again with that old steel guitar. Take it, Leon. Take it away, boy. Take it.
Isn't that fantastic? I could listen to that. I could want to learn how to play that. I would want to keep that going. Now, life on the road is very, very demanding. And Bob often went through many band members, including steel guitar players. That's a double-edged sword. It's good for us because we get to hear many different steel guitar players over Bob's career. One of the next guys to step up was the great Herb Remington. Look up Herb Remington. He was the composer of Remington's Ride, as well as many, many other tunes. And it was a very special time when Herb Remington was in the band, because that was at the same time Junior Barnard was in the band and Tiny Moore on electric mandolin. You had a power trio of amazing players, all plugged in, oftentimes doing twin work, complementing each other's leads, passed around, true jazz style, both the melody as well as improvisation.
Maurice Anderson, look out there, man. Yeah.
Now, there's a great story about Herb Remington joining the band. It was one of Herb's first or second gigs. He was a young kid at the time. He was maybe 18 or 19 years old. And he was on stage, and he asked Bob, you know, his boss, well, when you want me to solo, what do you want me to play? And Bob just turned to him and said, play something interesting. So it comes his time to solo, and that was often indicated by Bob waving his fiddle bow at you, because despite the intense rehearsal schedule of the Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys, on stage, it was anything goes. It was heads up ball. If Bob pointed at you, you played, and you played your butt off. So it comes time for Herb Remington to play his solo. Who knows how many people were there? He's new in the band. He goes to play. Nothing. There was a malfunction with the cord, the amp, and he got so frustrated that in front of the whole crowd, kicks the steel guitar, it goes tumbling off the stage, he stands up in a huff, and without missing a beat, Bob, the consummate showman, says, well, that was interesting. That's a great story that was relayed to me about Herb Remington. Many other steel guitar players graced the stage with Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. The great Noel Boggs, composer of the song Stealin' Home, which I learned from Billy Wilson and I've been covering for a long time. Billy Bowman, Gene Crownover, Roy Honeycutt, and of course the great Vance Terry, who played a lot of shows with Billy Jack Wills as well as Bob Wills. Billy Jack Wills, as we know, is Bob's youngest brother, and Vance played a lot at Wills Point, like we talked about in our last segment, as well as down at the DeMarco's 23 Club in Brisbane, California, just south of San Francisco. That was where the album Brisbane Bop was recorded with Jimmy Rivers and his New Cherokees. And that's Vance Terry playing all those piano-like chord voicings on the guitar. I've been told by my dear friend Billy Wilson, who was good friends with Vance Terry, that he was the sweetest guy. And if you were on stage with Vance and you took a great solo, Vance would say, if I could play guitar like you, I'd play like you. Now, six string slingers in the Texas Playboys include Junior Barnard and Eldon Shamblin. So Eldon Shamblin was like the Freddie Green of Western swing. Freddie Green was Count Basie's rhythm guitar player for almost three decades. Eldon Shamblin was the rhythm guitar player and also great lead player in Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. And he played a Strat. A solid body sounded like a hollow body. Thank you. playing was phenomenal. Now, we mentioned earlier the great Junior Barnard. Now, his distorted tone was a thing of its own. And he recorded Barnard's Blues. And now this is volume 3 of the Tiffany transcriptions, which were actually recorded up here in San Francisco. Let's take a listen right now to that sizzling sound of Barnard's Blues.
Here's that fat boy again with them old Barnard blues this time. In fact, that's Junior Barnard playing it. I'll get it low, Junior, or else ride it high. Oh. Women and children hollering, Willy Willy. Oh, killing me. Sour pats out, let the milk come down. Ah! Yeah! Here's that boy Kelso. Mama pin a rose on me.
Oh.
Mama pin a rose on me.
Some reason for that, why?
Got them old Barnard blues.
Oh.
Blue as I can be.
Well, glad, Mr. Barnard. Yeah.
Come on, hide with a razor.
Oh.
Yeah, come in, Jody.
Again, these guys are pioneers. This is fantastic music.
Tommy Duncan was a mainstay in the Bob Wills Band for a decade, until he wasn't.
Beneath a neon star in a honky-tonk, I fell in love with you. Sitting at the bar neath the neon star, you said you loved me too. Was it the wine when your eyes met mine? Was it the beer made you call me dear? Still at any old rate on a very first date, you made my dreams come true. Beneath the neon star in a honky-tonk, I fell in love with you.
In the late 1940s, and still a binge drinker, Wills became increasingly unreliable on stage, causing a rift with Tommy Duncan, who was always on stage to receive the audience's anger when Wills' booze binges prevented him from appearing. Wills fired Duncan in the fall of 1948 and put an end to that. Now, Bob Wills had lived a lavish lifestyle in California, but in 1949, he moved back to Oklahoma City and went back on tour to maintain his big payroll. In 1950, Wills had a couple top 10 hits, like Faded Love, and continued to tour and record throughout the 1950s and into the early 60s, despite the fact that Western Swing's popularity, even in the Southwest, had diminished greatly. He kept the band on the road well into the 60s, and eventually moved back to where it all started in Fort Worth in 1961. But in 1965, after two heart attacks, he had to dissolve the Texas Playboys, who continued as an independent unit. Wills would still perform solo with house bands and did real well in Las Vegas, and he made some records, but he was largely a forgotten figure, even though he was inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame in 1968. In 69, the day after ceremonies in Texas honoring Wills for his contribution to Western Swing, Wills had a series of strokes that left his right side paralyzed, ending his career. He actually appeared vocally on a couple tracks in 73 when Merle Haggard made his reunion tribute to Bob Wills and his band called For the Last Time.
The Texas Playboys are on the air.
Listen, everybody from near and far, if you want to know who we are, we're the Texas Playboys from the Lone Star State.
Will suffered yet another stroke midway through that session and remained comatose until his death in 1975. Bob Wills is only one of a handful of people to be inducted into both the Country Music Hall of Fame and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Steve Hathaway was in college when he saw Commander Cody in The Lost Planet Airmen, and then Asleep at the Wheel. And Western Swing grabbed a hold of him. As Stompin' Steve Hathaway, he has hosted a weekly radio program, The Cupertino Barn Dance, since 1972. K-Cup 91.5, 9 to midnight on Saturdays. Stompin' Steve wrote a short biography of two of Bob Wills' siblings, Billy Jack Wills and Luke Wills, for the Encyclopedia of Country Music. Ladies and gentlemen, Stompin' Steve Hathaway.
Hi, Mitch, Chris, Robert. This is Steve Hathaway. I've been doing a classic country radio show on KKUP in Cupertino for 49 years now, and I have a particular love of Western Swing music. Of course, Bob Wills, one of the founders of Western Swing. He had a long recording career starting back in the 30s on Columbia Records and till his death when he was on United Artists. Anyway, between his Columbia and MGM days in the mid-40s, Bob was living here in California in Fresno. He had an 80-acre ranch and toured extensively up and down the West Coast. During that time, he made a contract with Tiffany Music in Oakland, California to produce a series of radio transcriptions. In fact, that's what they are. They're big 16-inch discs, a little bit bigger than an LP, and they were sent to radio stations to play. It was helped to promote their tours, among other things. What was particularly great about the Tiffany transcriptions is that these were, because of the format, they were allowed to go beyond the normal time restraints of the 78 record, which usually had to be well under 3 minutes. The Tiffany transcriptions were a lot looser. more like what you hear if you saw them live. And this is a particularly great band during this time period of 1946 and 47. Bob had, of course, started off as a string band, and eventually by the early war years had a full horn band with that could rival any of the West, you know, Western swing and swing bands both. After the war, obviously for financial purposes and the like, couldn't afford to keep such a large group together, and relied more on the amplified guitars, guitar, steel guitar, electric mandolin, to boost the sound for the dances that he performed at. During this period, he had some of the greatest musicians I think he ever had in his band. People like Herb Remington on steel, Joe Hawley on fiddle, Junior Bernard on electric guitar, way underrated. And of course, this period of Tiffany transcriptions were all reissued by Kaleidoscope Records in the Bay Area in 1982. They put out a series of 10 LPs. This was the first one right here in 82. And then eventually they licensed the rights to Rhino Records, which reissued them all. And they've been out of print for a while. A few years back, Collector Choice, the reissue company, put them all out on a little CD box set. And since then, that's been the only way you can get those Tiffany transcriptions, unless you happen to come across the originals. But even then, there was a lot more recorded that went beyond what was on the disc. And a lot of those are preserved by the Jeff Alexson and Tom Diamon at Kaleidoscope. And anyway, Rhino, I guess, has the rights to license them. And Real Gone Music in Tustin, California, has put out a couple collections of previously unissued Tiffany's that weren't on the original 10 disc. This is the first one that came out during Record Store Day in 2015. It came out with an LP that has additional bonus tracks, which you can find probably on eBay. And just recently, they put out a second collection of another 50 tracks of Tiffany transcriptions. And I'm gonna share with you one of those tracks tonight, or this afternoon, I guess, for playing this. And it features Luke Wills, one of Bob Wills' brothers, and he made very few recordings. I mean, he wasn't the greatest vocalist, but you'll see that this is a pretty fine song. It's a swing standard, and it's one that features Joe Hawley on fiddle. You'll hear, I think, of course, Junior Bernard on electric guitar, and the piano is Millard Kelso, who was a really great piano player who was here on the West Coast at the time. So here it goes.
You're part of me, honey, that's plain to see. In your eyes, you're telling lies to me. Poverty come down to your door. You begin to change vows that you made before. Oh, my dear, you could have spared my aching heart. Had only warned me from the start. Oh, you're tired of me, baby. Why can't we be like we were before you grew so hard?
Next up, a music historian who has appeared dozens of times on Eclectic American Roots, Big Sandy. He's a legend among roots fans all over the world. In 1988, when he was starting out over 30 years ago, his band, the Flyright Boys, boasted a honky-tonk piano and a steel guitar and were widely known as a Western swing band. Here is Big Sandy to give us more insight into how Bob Wills affected his long musical career.
Thank you, Christopher. Big Sandy here. And I'm very happy to stop in today to talk a little bit about the man, Bob Wills, and what a big impact his music has had on mine over the years. Big Sandy and the Flyright Boys. We started off as Big Sandy and the Flyright Trio in 1988, playing straight-ahead rockabilly music. But something happened along the way that shifted our musical direction. We started to listen to Bob Wills, basically. In 2008, I was one of a few people to write the liner notes for a 10-CD box set of Bob Wills' Tiffany transcriptions. I'm just going to read an excerpt of the liner notes that I wrote for that collection right now, because it sort of tells the story. Okay. In those pre-download days, road tapes, homemade cassette compilations played an essential part in the daily life of every band that dared to pile into a beat-up van and venture out across the country. Much like the oft-heard expression, you are what you eat, I've always maintained that musically speaking, you are what you listen to. And as a band on the road, we survived on a steady diet of Gene Vincent, Johnny Burnett, Starday compilations, and whatever rare rockabilly 45s I could get my hands on and dub onto cassette. But then something happened. TK Smith, our nimble-fingered guitarist, asked if I, the self-appointed van DJ, wouldn't mind playing something of his. And that was a Bob Wills album called The Tiffany Transcriptions. And he had transferred that onto cassette tape. And man alive, I mean, I had plenty of Bob Wills 78s in my collection, and dug his music completely, but this was different. It jumped, it swung, it rocked, it was alive, it was fun, it was real, man. And for the next 45 miles, then 90 miles, then 135 miles, and so on, the sounds that leaped out of those crummy van speakers forever changed our band's listening habits, and eventually changed the way we approached our music. All right, just a small excerpt of the liner notes from the Bob Wills 10-CD box set, The Tiffany Transcriptions. And it's all true. Things really did shift for us after listening to Bob's music in that band van of ours over the miles. We started to look for a steel player, and we found a great one in Lee Jeffries, who played a beautiful triple-neck Bigsby steel guitar. We ended up adding Carl Sonny Leyland on piano. And in the studio, we recorded at the Capitol Tower in Hollywood. We had fiddle on our sessions. We had Brantley Kearns, who was playing with Dwight Yoakam at the time. And it was just a lot of fun being inspired by some of the great Texas Playboys, Western swing music. And it found its way into our music in different ways. Although we were never a proper Western swing band, we sure loved it, dug it, and it came out in our music. And I think the peak of that period of the band was captured on a live TV show that we did in the Conan O'Brien show. So I thought it might be nice to take a look at that right now. Here we are with all the Flyright Boys, feeling kind of lucky.
Big Sandy and his Flyright Boys.
Well, all the stars are out tonight and everybody's high. I wish I may, I wish I might. Feeling kind of lucky. Step aside, you gentlemen, let me pass on by. Well, I'm looking at the women that feeling kind of lucky. Who I'm gonna win now? Who I'm in likely now? Oh, 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 place my bet on that brunette. She's giving me the high, and I know I hit her number yet. Millionaire, no ordinary guy. Well, if
it's 12 o'clock and I don't care. Feeling kind of lucky. Well, I'm not superstitious, but there's genie passing by. And I know she'll grant my wishes, boys. Feeling kind of lucky. I feel kind of fun now. I feel like a bum now. Bring one on now. I got no worries, got no blues. I feel like I could fly. The odds are stacked, I just can't lose. Feeling kind of lucky. Now, let me in now. Yes, all the stars are out tonight, and everybody's high. I wish I may, I think I might. Feeling kind of lucky. Ooh, feeling kind of lucky. Whoa, I'm
very much. Don't try it.
So, man.
Yeah. Big Sandy and his Fly Right Boys. Everybody will take a break. We'll be right back. That was great.
Back on the Polzak Ponderosa, Mitch is waiting in the wings to bring you another batch of classic cuts.
All right, friends, we continue our role of Western Swing on Eclectic American Roots. The third segment that I'm going to talk about today is entitled Bob Wills to Bakersfield, Pioneer of the West Coast Sound. Thus far, we've talked about the evolution of Western Swing in the state of California, its rollicking sounds and dance halls, its fantastic string arrangements, distorted electric guitar solos, and full tilt energy. Now, during the 30s, a lot of folks came out from the South because of the Dust Bowl. There was not a lot of money at that time, but there was better opportunities in California. And as they were called at the time, Okies, Arkies, folks from that part of the country where the Dust Bowl was ravaging plains, crops, and the economy, came out here. They brought the music with them. And that set up a great listening audience who knew and loved this kind of music already in the state of California. Enter World War II, all of a sudden there became a lot of jobs available out in California, in the Bay Area, in Southern California, in Oregon and Washington as well with the timber industry. So that brought a massive influx of people. Now, after coming back from a stint in World War II, servicemen and women were anxious to hear the music that they grew up with, to hear the sounds that reminded them of home, reminded them of family. So that combined with jobs, with disposable income, meant there was money to have a good time. There was room and reason and means to honky tonk. So whenever you have those, you have a demand. Clubs went up, venues went up. There was demand for live music, Western Swing, 7 nights a week. You could go out and hear amazing acts and touring acts, and there was all this money available for bands to be working. So, to continue with that electrifying sound that Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys brought us, on to the 50s, we had acts such as the Maddox Brothers and Rose, America's most colorful hillbilly band, driving up and down the San Joaquin in their Cadillacs, playing their electrified music, playing their good time show, rocking people. They hired 15-year-old Roy Nichols, an electric guitarist who later went on to be Merle Haggard's electric guitar player for decades, got to start playing with Maddox Brothers and Rose. And at this time, in the 50s, Bob wasn't touring with his enormous band anymore. There wasn't quite the economy there was after World War II. Smaller honky-tonk bands consisting of an electric guitar, pedal steel guitar at this point, lap steel by this, by these early 60s had kind of gone by the wayside. You had four or five piece bands. Oftentimes we still have a fiddle, electric guitar, steel or pedal steel guitar, bass and drums. And also towards the late 50s you had the invention and the prominence of the electric bass, which further added to the volume of the sound that you could play with different band members over a roar of people. And you had what was becoming that we know today as the Bakersfield sound or the West Coast sound. We had mentioned the Maddox Brothers and Rose, and we also had bands with Dude Martin, with Ray Wade, who hired Bill Woods, who was a seminal figure in Bakersfield music. Bill Woods was so influential. We should look up Bill Woods. Look up Bill Woods of Bakersfield. We had Dave Stogner, Jimmy Rivers and the New Cherokees. Now, Jimmy Rivers is playing a double neck guitar, 6-string and 12-string, a Gibson, way before any rock band from England was doing that. Again, pioneers of this sound, friends. And also bringing us that classic California sound, Don Rich, who was originally from Tumwater, Washington, started out on fiddle and hired by Buck Owens when he was just 16 or 17 years old. We had, of course, Red Simpson from Oildale, California, which was the birthplace of Merle Haggard. Joe Mathis came out to play. So Joe Mathis was flat picking fiddle tunes at that point on electric guitar. And the famous Tiffany transcriptions, where we have so much of Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys music recorded, was actually recorded in San Francisco. I hear that there's another volume of that being released, which is very, very exciting. So it's amazing to look at where this music comes from. Friends, all of our heroes, they listen to somebody. Those people listen to somebody. Friends, this music is not good because it's old. It's old because it's good. It has staying power. It sings about the human condition in a way that's not overproduced or made too slick. It's accessible. It involves us all. And it's important to remember that this music is still happening, as we have seen here on this episode of Eclectic American Roots, by our contemporaries making incredible music. And that this music ties in to not just one genre, but ties into so many different genres, so many different experiences, but at the same time, it's the human condition. So as we go away from this episode today, let's remember to treat this music as a current, living, breathing entity. Let's continue to share this music with friends, with family, and people who like music from the heart. It's been a pleasure to get to talk with you today and share a little bit about Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys, to go into depth on sounds, on steel guitar players, and of course, the impact of Bob's music here in California. So, my name is Mitch Polzak. I'm honored to be on Eclectic American Roots. Let's stick around and see what else is in this episode and celebrate Hillbilly Jazz.
Northern California Greg Yanito began his musical adventures at age 6, playing the accordion. Nowadays, he most often can be found behind a 6-string guitar, an upright bass, or a microphone, leading the San Francisco Western dance band named the B-Stars. They were formed in 2006 and have played hundreds of club dates on the West Coast and as far away as Spain. He's a band leader, musician, DJ, and dancer. Greg also operates Rust Belt Recordings. Say hello to Greg Yanito.
Hi there, friends. Greg Yanito here, calling in from San Francisco. Thanks, Christopher, for the introduction, and thanks for having me on here. I will say that Bob Wills has influenced my musical projects, and in particular my Western dance band, the B-Stars, over the years, for, you know, a couple different reasons. First, as a band leader, he had the chance to work with some of the brightest and best players of the day, and you know, didn't shy away from calling them out and giving them the spotlight. You know, it's important to me to recognize the people I'm playing with and call them out as well. But can you imagine playing alongside of Herb Remington or Liam McAuliffe or Junior Bernard, Tiny Moore, and how exciting that would be? Well, you don't need to imagine. You just need to listen to some of the recordings and hear Bob call them out and say, oh, man, yes, you know, this is it. This is just great. And he really just got into it, and his excitement then made them play better, and them playing better made him excited, and then, you know, it translates to the crowd. You know, it's an energy exchange there. Bob was a merchandising and visionary kind of guy. He pitched an idea along with Milton Brown to do a radio spot with the Lightcrest Doughboys. It was an advertising thing for the Burr's Flour Mill, and this came before Mother's Best and Hank Williams, and it was a brilliant idea. He was able to get himself into every household at noon. You know, people would turn on the radio every day at noon to hear Bob Wills, and he became a household name. Brilliant, brilliant idea. The third thing I just want to mention is that he played, you know, a new genre of music, Western swing. You know, it's a combination that bridges folk music and blues and jazz, and it's a vernacular indigenous kind of thing. It's salt of the earth music. It's straight down the middle of the plate, and it spoke to a lot of people. And, you know, that's also a key to his lasting success and transcription till today. It means a lot to me as a dancer. You know, I try to create an energy for the dance community and take that energy back to the band. And he did that in a way that, you know, I listen to his records over and over, and I'm always hearing something new. But the thing that stands out the most is just how the music gels all together. And it's like a rhythmic tidal wave that just overwhelms me. And I don't know how people can't just get up and dance to it. It's just overwhelming sometimes. This is obviously a Bill Haley video riff that we created about, a number of years ago with the help of Rick Pendleton, who directed the video. But this is a house party. This is the B-Stars playing at a house party and a house dance party, which I hope you like. This is called Still Waiting, and thanks again for having me on. Take care.
Hey, Pete, we must be out of our minds. We don't belong here.
Maybe so, but something's getting these people out of their houses. I want to find out what it is.
It sounds like they're skinning cats in there.
Sunday morning shines so bright, my head's still spinning from last night. I'm waiting, I'm still waiting. I ask if you will come with me down to the lake down by the tree. Just a chance to get away, to hear sweet words that you might say. Here you're standing with a smile, not a word for the longest while. I'm waiting, still waiting. I'm waiting for a subtle clue or anything at all from you. I'm waiting for one slow dance, waiting just to take a chance. I'm waiting here to catch your eye, for the chance to kiss goodbye. And I'm waiting, I'm still waiting. I bought a ring, it's just your size. Shouldn't come as no surprise. I'm waiting for the time to ride. It just might be tomorrow night. Here I am on bended knee. Forever will you be with me. And I'm waiting. I'm still waiting. I'm waiting for a subtle clue or anything at all from you. Well, I'm waiting for one. Here to catch your eye for the chance to kiss goodbye. I'm waiting. I'm still waiting. Yes, I'm waiting. I'm still waiting.
It's time to meet another Texas Western Swing band leader. In over 40 years of music making, Billy Mata and the Texas Tradition has performed throughout America and Europe. They've enjoyed regular rotation on Sirius XM, and he is a two-time Ameripolitan Western Swing winner. Billy has performed with the Texas Playboys, featuring Tommy Alsup and Leon Rausch. He has become the heir apparent to Bob Wills and is also well known as the ambassador of Western Swing. Welcome, Billy Mata.
Hi, this is Billy Mata. I sure hope you're enjoying this program. I wanted to give my perspective on Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys and his influence on my life. Being a native San Antonian, you know, everybody growing up from my era remembers the song San Antonio Rose. And it was such an impactful song, crossing many cultural lines, because being that my father, he was from Mexico, he enjoyed the type of stuff that Bob did because it was incorporated horns and strings. And San Antonio Rose was no different than a Mexican polka beat. And so he was a big Bob Wills fan. And so growing up hearing that, you know, hearing my father talking about it alongside of his kind of music that he liked, it kind of caught my ear. And later on, I realized that Bob Wills was the leader of the band, and he had several different singers that had worked for him. One in particular, Tommy Duncan, who influenced me without realizing it. You know, I mean, he's one of those guys that can do any song from blues to hoedowns to big band crooner tunes. He was that Mr. Versatility type of singer. And which is something I always strived for myself. So, you know, it prompted me to do some research on it, and I was able to do the Tommy Duncan trilogy, which was a massive project, but it was well worth the time and effort. So, from an early age, yeah, I can remember Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys having that influence on me, and later on in life, in my career, putting what I remember as a kid through what I went through growing up through the music business and seeing where not just me, but many singers before me that went to listen to Tommy Duncan, you know, and had tried to emulate that vocal style. So anyway, I hope that that gives you my perspective of what we're doing. So, and I hope you enjoy the show, and we'll talk to you soon. Thank you.
Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys. At the letters that you wrote to me, it is you that I Remember I faded love.
The legacy of Bob Wills would be less impressive if he hadn't consistently worked with extraordinary musicians like Jesse Ashlock, Sleepy Johnson, Leon McAuliffe, Eldon Shamblin, Noah Boggs, Johnny Gimble, Jimmy Widener, Herb Remington, and more. Wills was successful at bridging the gap between the race music of his era and the rockabilly, bebop, and rock and roll years. His style of music influenced performers as varied as Hank Williams, Chuck Berry, and Jimi Hendrix. He heavily influenced Buck Owens and Merle Haggard, and he helped to spawn the Bakersfield sound, which was one of Wills' regular stops back in his heyday. That's our show. Now you know why Bob Wills is still the king. Thanks to our video host, Mitch Polzak, and all our contributors today. View all of our past Eclectic American Roots shows on YouTube on our channel called Stellar JAX. Hasta la vista.